Never have we needed nature-friendly farming as much as we do now. Put it the other way around, unfriendly towards nature farming has not been a wonderful success. Indeed, the great challenges of our time, the protection and enhancement of natural capital and biodiversity, and addressing climate change can't be done without a radical rethink about how we use the land, and at the core of that is how we do our farming. So let me start off by just reminding us of the scale of the challenges we confront at the global level in order to contextualize what we have to do locally on every farm everywhere. So globally, we've been adding 2 parts per million to the concentration of carbon in the atmosphere for over 30 years, ever since 1990, when we were supposed to be doing something about climate change. That is terrible because the carbon concentration in the atmosphere is the only number that matters. That is what the greenhouse effect is all about. And even last year, in the great lockdowns, we still added another 2 parts per million. So we have to rethink radically our carbon consumption, our carbon production, and how we do the two things that matter: reduce emissions on the one hand, and sequestrate the carbon on the other. And when it comes to a country like the UK, with its own net zero territorial carbon production targets, so they're not inclusive of all aspects of carbon consumption, that's a problem. But we have nevertheless dramatic targets, including to reduce emissions by 78% by 2035. That's 13, half 14 years away. And we're supposed to eliminate carbon in the sense of be net zero within less than 29 years. That's huge on any scale. And if we think about where these problems have to be addressed, and thinking about the balance between emissions on the one side and sequestration on the other, there is no sector more important than agriculture. It might be only 0.5% of GDP, but it has a measured emissions of about 11%. So it's the largest relative polluting sector in climate change terms in the country. So not only does it have that, but remember too that 11% does not properly measure the carbon in the soils and its loss and peat losses. And you'll know better than me that carbon is an immense part of our soil story. The soil has perhaps 3 to 4 times the carbon in the atmosphere. So, put it another way, without substantive change to agriculture, we aren't going to crack our contribution to dealing with climate change. So, in going about this, we have a raft of new legislation which sets the scene for UK post Brexit policies, some of them different in the regions, but the overarching sense of direction is the same. So we have that net zero target, which was an amendment in 2019 to the Climate Change Act. We have the Agriculture Act, which replaces the old CAP framework with public money for public goods and the tiered system, starting with the Sustainable Farming Initiative and then the local and national recovery schemes, or tiers. And then on top of that, we have the Environment Bill about to become law, which provides for statutory targets for water, air, biodiversity, and waste to add to the carbon requirement. And it's supported by the Office of Environmental Protection. And all of this is embedding the 25-year environment plan, which in our time, the Natural Capital Committee developed, proposed, and got accepted by the then Secretary of State, Michael Gove. Oh, and then there's new planning legislation as well. So it's a big new world. And in this world, thinking about what farming can do, we have to try to take a holistic view about nature as a whole, including the climate. We have to understand where we are, and we have to work out what we need to do to hold the line, which we're not doing at the moment, and what we need to do to get all those enormous benefits that come from investing in natural capital. So how do we do this? Well, the place to start is with a baseline. Sounds obvious, but it's remarkable how many people think that we can work out how to take our land use forward without working out, first of all, what the line is against we have to measure progress. So we need to do that. And that needs to be a natural capital asset-based approach. It's not just about ecosystem services, but it's about the assets which are the basis from which those services are developed. It's a balance sheet. We have to know what soil assets we've got. We have to know what forestry and other assets we've got. We have to know what the water assets look like. We have to know about the assets in respect of air quality, and so on and so forth. And of course, we have to know about the biodiversity. So start off with a baseline. There's no perfect way of doing those. They're going to be a mixture of satellite information and on the ground surveys, and frankly, the nous of the farmers who manage the land and know it best. The next thing we have to do is work out the capital maintenance. Land is an asset in perpetuity. It can't be properly depreciated. We have to spend what's necessary to maintain it at least intact. That's a charge for our current spending, our current revenues. It's not a balance sheet item in itself. So we've got to work that out. And some areas that'll be straightforward, in others it'll be more difficult. But we have to provide for that. And then we have to look to the opportunities. What can we do to make things better? What can we do to have better natural capital that the next generation can inherit? Better climate, better environment, more biodiversity. And every farmer knows that there are a suite of opportunities on their particular patch. They know that well. And if we want to be nature friendly, and frankly, we can't afford not to be, we need to sort out which ones of those offer the greatest natural capital bucks for the cost of doing them, and turn to the support regimes that are available under the ELMS and so on to prop those up. And once we have those are asset sheet enhancements. They go onto the balance sheet and they measure how well our stewardship is of adding to the asset base we have at the moment. So that's all practical and doable. And within that frame, the opportunities are just legion. There's carbon offsets. There's genuine carbon sequestration, which involves the tricky issue of specifying what the counterfactual is. What would have happened if you didn't do the extra carbon sequestration measures that you propose? There's the multiple benefits that come from agroforestry, for example. There are the water benefits. There's the mental and physical health gains. There's the biodiversity that comes. And part of that will be increased by simply improving the carbon in the soil, which is a good measure, crude, but good measure of how much biodiversity there is in those soils. And we all know that most biodiversity is beneath our feet and not above the ground. So we need to do all of those things, think through how to achieve those outcomes. And then it's the messy business of the money. What pays for what? And this comes in two parts. It's my view that the polluter should pay. And agriculture is a really big polluter. We should have taxes on the pesticides, the fertilizers. There should be charges for enforcing nitrate neutrality. We've got to make sure that farmers are not distinct from all the rest of us who are expect to pay when we pollute the environment and damage others. So we need that side and those revenues from those pollution charges needs to be spent in ways which can enhance our environment. And then we need to look on the other side and look for supports and subsidies, and that's where hopefully the old CAP money is going to be directed to a much better place. And we can only know whether that money's spent well if we do two things. One is we carefully measure it against the baseline, but the second is we do it in a holistic and integrated way in looking at land management. And that means thinking about catchments, thinking about rivers, thinking about where funding comes through river systems, as well as it means looking at our uplands in a more complete and integrated way. Do all of that, and we will generally have nature-friendly farming. And that is a huge opportunity, and what's more, it's sustainable. And you might say, well, maybe, but you know, who's going to pay it? What customer's going to pay for food that's going to be more expensive, et cetera, et cetera. But let me put it to you like this in conclusion. Going on like we are in agriculture is not sustainable. I find very few people who would disagree with me on that. But if it's not sustainable, it will not be sustained. And so ultimately, there's only one way to go: sustainable, nature-friendly farming. And I wish you well in your endeavours. Thank you.